Well, hello, everyone. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning. Wow, that sounds so exciting to say that. We have folks joining us from all the different time zones and different countries, and it's so thrilling to be able to kick off this, our first International Patient Conference. Welcome to everyone. I'm Susan Thornton, the CEO of the Cutaneous Lymphoma Foundation. And if you are joining us for the first time, we are so thrilled to have you. This has been a vision that we have had for quite a long time. And I think over the last year with COVID and all the things that have been going on around the globe, it became even more apparent how important it is to bring together our global patient community. And I will have to say, our guests this evening, Mickey and Ton, who are joining us from the Netherlands, you know, Mickey was really the inspiration for thinking about how do we bring together the global community of cutaneous lymphoma patients and family members. She reached out to me a couple of years ago as they were embarking on their journey in the Netherlands, which they will share with you tonight. But I think it really showed the importance of being able to build this network for all of us so that we can share and collaborate and connect no matter where we are in the world, and to build this connection within specific countries and regions and languages, but also to put everybody together. Because I think what you'll learn over the next day with the programs and the sessions that we've got planned is the importance of bringing our collective voices together and being able to share with governments and health systems and the researchers and the clinicians, you know, what's important to us who are living with cutaneous lymphoma. And for those of you, again, that have not met me before, I'm also a patient. I always like to share that. I've been living with mycosis fungoides for close to 30 years, and it's been quite the adventure. I'm always happy to share. If anybody has questions later, we're going to open it up for just a meet and greet after this. So I want to also take a moment to thank our sponsors and the people that have enabled us to make this program possible. As you can imagine, you know, behind the scenes, there's been a lot of things happening and using technology, which is wonderful, but we don't necessarily have all of that expertise. So it really is important for us to be able to thank those who are supporting us and all of our individual donors who support the work we do. We are so grateful. So without further ado, I am going to introduce my wonderful guests, Ton and Mickey DeLau, who are joining us from their home in the Netherlands, where it's 7 p.m. in the evening. And it's really great to have you both with us. You've been on quite the adventure. I'm really excited for you to share both your personal journey, Mickey, and what it's been like for you living with Sézary, but also the adventure of building the patient organization and kind of how that's come to be. I think this, you're so inspiring, and I'm really thrilled that you'll be able to share with our audience here a little bit about what you've been up to and your experience. So I'm going to turn it over to both of you to take it from here. Great. And then I'll jump in probably somewhere along the way. But I'm going to turn it over to you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, we are Mieke and Ton de Leeuw, and we have started together with some other volunteers, the Dutch Cutaneous Lymphoma Foundation, Stichting Huidlymfoom in Dutch. But before we tell something more about what we do as a foundation, I want to tell something about the Dutch healthcare system. Maybe next slide. The Dutch healthcare system is one of the best of the world. everyone in the Netherlands pays for it, as if they have any money, through taxes and compulsory basic health insurance. In this way, all young, old, healthy or ill can count on good care when we need it. Compared to other countries, the Dutch experience a below average threshold for making use of care due to lack of money, travel distance or waiting time. Money is not an issue and everyone gets the care they need, even for expensive cancer treatments. It's not this way in all countries, sadly enough. Financial aspects were therefore not an issue for us when Mieke was diagnosed with cutaneous lymphoma. And Mieke will tell about her journey in the next slide.
Thank you. As Susan and Ton already told you, my name is Mieke de Leeuw. I'm 69 years old, married with Ton. Ton is 74 years old. We have 4 children, 2 of our own and 2 married into the family, and 4 grandchildren. And our daughter is watching us now. We are retired and live in Venlo in the south of Holland, a few miles from the border with Germany and Belgium. Our Dutch Lymphoma Foundation, Stichting Huidlymfoom, is a patient organization for patients with a form of cutaneous lymphoma. My husband Tom is also a very active volunteer in our foundation since 2018. Tom will tell you more about our Dutch foundation. The diagnosis of cutaneous lymphoma can turn your life upside down, as you all know. The diagnosis, treatments, and the time afterwards raise many questions. By my start, the discovery of a bump above my collarbone in 2017 set off a lengthy testing trajectory. But it began before that, 10 years of skin conditions that got worse and worse, and that were hard to live with. Numerous wrong diagnoses and doctors saying, it's not that bad, or you'll have to learn to live with it. My skin was red, itching and burning, and it was very difficult to sleep at night with these problems. And during the day, it was difficult to stay concentrated on my job. On the slide shown, you can see how my cancer has progressed so far and what the value of our foundation and other patient organizations has been to me over the last few years. In 2018, I thought, am I going to die? Rather not. But after months of waiting in 2018, finally a diagnosis arrived, 2 rare non-Hodgkin cancers, mantle cell lymphoma, a form of lymph node cancer, and Sézary syndrome, both incurable. And with 2 cancers, you are in Holland not allowed to participate in research studies. For Sézary syndrome, 5-year survival rate of 23 at my stage. The MCL turned out to be indolent. The first year after the diagnosis, you are mainly concerned with yourself. If you are unlucky, are you going to get very sick or not? What does the survival rate mean? Some fellow sufferers are going to clean up their house, done with their lives. Unfortunately, a diagnosis that comes too late means more severe treatment and worse prospects, and therefore a worse 5-year survival chance. Suddenly, I also had to deal with the fragility of life. My story is also the story and the fate of many patients with rare forms of cancer. In 2019, there was for me loneliness. The second year after the diagnosis and the start of the systemic treatment, chemo pills and prednisone, was scary. Would it all work? I read on internet long-time treatment with a combination of low-dose chlorambucil and prednisone is often effective in controlling disease Sézary syndrome, but is unlikely to yield complete responses. There was nobody with Sézary syndrome to talk to. It was very, very lonely. But then I discovered the Cutaneous Lymphoma Foundation on internet and the Facebook group Sézary syndrome.
Next slide, please. Yes.
The Sézary Facebook group is for people who have Sézary syndrome and their caregivers, family, friends, and supporters. A group to share information, experiences, strength, hope, and information. I would like to read you some examples of comments from this special Facebook group.
Next slide, please. Next slide. Yes, yeah. Thank you. My husband was diagnosed last year, and we are really finding it so hard to get medication because of finances. We can't even afford a phototherapy machine, one of the comments.
We got married when Jasper was very, very ill with Sézary syndrome. He got a very aggressive variant. 5 years later, we are enjoying life as cancer-free since 4 years.
I have tried different lotions and creams, but mostly made me feel slimy. Are there any other medications anyone has found to be effective for the itch?
Hi, everyone. My husband is stage 3B Sézary and has been on a number of chemo drugs. Now his oncologist wants to try him on MOGA. Can anyone tell us their experience on this drug?
Any ideas on life expectancy? Please delete if this is inappropriate. Hello, S. I don't think any question is inappropriate. Always reach out if you are worried. None of us know how long we have. Taking small steps leads to a safer journey. Ask the questions, talk about your feelings, hug longer, laugh louder, and love harder. Your life is fragile now, so take care of yourself. Sending love from Dublin.
The Facebook group was very helpful. I read reports from America and Australia that stated how fellow sufferers dealt with their illness. It was for me very nice to read that there were many fellow sufferers who had a good quality life for years after diagnosis. Ton and I are proud that in the past years, our foundation has developed. Ton will tell you more about this.
Yes, please, next slide. Yes, that's all you need here.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yes, I'm here, Mika. You, okay. Yes, please. Next one, please. Next slide. Yes, here we see the different organizations which we are cooperating with. In the first place, there is the University Medical Center in Leiden, which is the only one with expertise on cutaneous lymphoma in the Netherlands and is internationally well known. Of course, our own foundation, which we initiated in 2018. We also have a Facebook group in the Netherlands with about 90 participants. And we participate in the platform for rare cancer, zeldzamekankers.nl. In the broader sense, we cooperate with the NFK, that's the Dutch Federation, umbrella federation for all patients with cancer. And there is a special site which all the information on all kinds of cancer, which is called kanker.nl. The Facebook group was already introduced. And of course, the Cutaneous Lymphoma Foundation is, and the European Reference Network are instant organizations which we cooperate with. Mieke, huh? Yes, now please the next one. Yes.
What is my goal? A life free of cutaneous lymphoma for everyone. I have now started the fourth year. Is the treatment providing what I want? Yes, it actually does, because the treatment plan still works well and the side effects are manageable or can be solved. I get more and more optimistic about my former pessimistic prospects. For me, this means that after 3 years, my perspective of time, my goals and my motivations have changed. I put much more emphasis on living by my values, how natural but special family and friendship are. Focusing my volunteering, like stimulating scientific research from perspective of patients. Because research is also given too little attention for rare forms of cancer. My lessons after living with a rare form of cancer for 3 years, accept what can't be changed, adapt and move on.
Yes. Well, maybe with the next slide, I will tell you something about our Dutch Cutaneous Lymphoma Foundation. We do all kinds of activities. And it is. The first one is providing information for patients. Mieke?
Oh yeah.
What we do.
What we do, yeah. Yes, I was looking for the tulips. The tulips
disappeared, yeah.
Providing information for patients, the website, partnering with the National Rare Cancer Platform and other patient organizations, providing correct information on the kanker.nl website, info all types of cancer, newsletters, brochures, and leaflets.
Yes. The second part of our activities is the patient advocacy. We do assess scientific research. I will tell you something more about it later. And we have contact with the expert center in Leiden to optimize their care. And that's one of the things I will tell in more detail and on not on the next, but the later slide. Please, the next slide. The third leg of activities is about fellow sufferers.
Organization of patient days, contact options, Facebook groups, and WhatsApp groups. And what is special for us? 5 years ago, we didn't know anything about about cutaneous lymphoma and about this rare cancer. 5 years ago, we didn't know anything. When you work on it, you can, hoe zeg je dat? Zet je dit neer?
Yeah. How do you organize this? And what do you have to do? That's one of the things we have to find out. So we, that's what we did in the last year. Maybe the next slide will show some example of what we do. Please, the next slide. Yes. The optimizing of the care in the expert center in Leiden. The Dutch Federation of Cancer Organizations is put down in 15 requirements what the expert center should do. And we try to get Leiden to meet all these 15 requirements. It doesn't meet them all yet, but they're getting there. One, I just made a few of these 15. One of them is offer complete care for people with cutaneous lymphoma in all stages. That means from diagnosis to treatment, aftercare and palliation. That's very important that it's all in one place. The second is provide oncological care by a specialized multidisciplinary team consisting of all medical disciplines involved. That's not often the case because there are more than just the doctors who are experienced in cutaneous lymphoma, which are necessary to get a patient's care. They should have a multidisciplinary outpatient clinic. They should consider and carry out groundbreaking thinking and interventions that have not been laid down yet in guidelines. They should treat a minimum of number of patients per year. In Netherlands, there are about 150 to 200 new continuous lymphoma patients per year. And it's very good that they all are treated in one just general hospital, which has experience with this. If you divide the information of the patients over many hospitals, then none of them can be an expert. Very important is also do scientific research and international cooperation. At the Leiden University Hospital is there very good in it. Offer optimal care aimed at quality of life, not only in relation to illness and treatment, but all aspects of quality of life. Ensure that patients can take control of their own care process. That's not often the case, but it's important that the patient has control over what is happening to him. And as last of the 15, that they evaluate their care and are transparent about the results. That is, that they don't hide what happens also when it's not that good. That's making a very important lesson we have learned. Next slide for Mieke to tell something about her last experiences.
We work together with the hospital in Leiden, as Tom told you, and we want to special thanks to Professor Maarten Vermeer from the LUMC and the specialist Safa Najit, a very, very special person for us.
Yes, our foundation was helped from the beginning from one of the researchers, Dr. Safa Najit, which was very, very helpful, and it still helps us with everything we want to do as a foundation. That's very important. Maybe another example which I can tell you about how we do with our patient organization. For instance, new target therapies against all types of cancers have improved the prognosis and thus the quality of life for cancer patients, but rare cancers like CTCL are lagging behind. Much research is still needed. The Leiden University has started a new study with 13 other European centers of the Cutaneous Lymphoma Working Group and Euroflow, and Leiden has requested our foundation to look at their application and research from a patient perspective and to provide comments that can be incorporated in the proposal. Our foundation then wrote a letter of support for this project and also looked closely at what we call the patient information letter. That's a letter which is important to inform patients who participate in this research with not too difficult explanation of what is going to happen so that the patient knows exactly what is waiting for him. The patient group finds the relevance of this research in this case exceptionally high. It's very important and it contributes to the quality of life of future patients. And we will be sharing, of course, the results with our patient group. In order to be able to access assess these types of studies and also to be able to carry out other activities relevant to patients. Training is required, and in the Netherlands, this is offered free of charge by professionals for patient groups. Another of an example of representing the interests of patients is that foundation volunteers participate in teaching training courses for nurses with oncological experience from a patient perspective. It's very important that nurses who deal with cancer learn how patients experience their diagnosis and the process of treatment and aftercare. And it has shown that these lessons are very useful. Mieke is there very active, and he has already about 200 nurses what they have to expect from patients and how patients feel about the care and everything what happens. So that's some of the things we want to tell. Maybe now Susan has some questions about this.
But before Susan difficult question says,
yeah.
We want to bring a toast on the
conference.
With water. On yes. Two beautiful days.
Beautiful days and good friends and better times ahead for everyone.
Yes.
That's lovely. Thank you both. And wow, I'm so excited what you have been able to accomplish. And I'm so grateful for your willingness and all of the people that are part of your organization to jump in and really try to move the needle forward. It's so fabulous. As you both know, I know Professor Vermeer and Dr. and Sasha, and they're amazing and wonderful. And really bringing this collaborative effort, right? We can share with you and you can share what we have with your patient community. And then the experiences that, and the things that you're participating in the Netherlands, quite frankly, from my personal perspective, is ahead of the curve for many countries, including the US. And I think we have the capacity now, and we have the collaboration with the clinical environment to really be able to look at some of those best practices, right, that are happening in different countries and share yeah. them and bring that full patient perspective to give some thought to how care can be delivered in different environments. Yes. I always think, go ahead, Tan.
Yeah, we also have in the last few months gotten contact with patients from Belgium. In Belgium, it's a bit less better than in the Netherlands. And mm-hmm. these patients come to our foundations to get the information they need. So that is nice that we can cooperate with other mm-hmm. Dutch-speaking country.
Exactly. Yeah. And I think, that's always been one of the challenges in a rare disease where the patients are scattered and we don't always yeah. know. They may be seen, for example, like in the Netherlands, the patients are seen in Leiden, but they may not live near Leiden, right?
Some live very far from Leiden. They have to travel 2 hours to get there. So mm-hmm. that's a problem for some patients. So. But we have a system here that Leiden has contact with all the other university hospitals, and the dermatologists there are in contact with Leiden, and they come together a few times a year to discuss their patients, so they can also treat the patients in the hospitals nearer to the homes of the people. So Mieke is also treated not in Leiden, but in Nijmegen, which is nearer mm-hmm. to us. If we had to go to Leiden, we would also have to travel 2 hours, and now we can be in Nijmegen in less than an hour.
Oh, yeah. That's great. And I think being able to capture that and what's happening in different parts of the world and take the best of all of those things and to share it and say, together we can work to say, here's from a patient's perspective, perhaps, you know, what we view as a gold standard. Not that everybody can meet that, but at least it's something to move towards. And how can we bring our experiences and our perspectives to the table? And this is just, we're just beginning, right? To really, again, try to pull the global patient community together, because your experience in the Netherlands is different than someone's in France, than someone's in South Africa or Brazil or in Mexico. So, and we know it's different. So, you know, having a place where people can come together and then we can try to figure out how to support is.
Yes, it's very important. We see that, I think many patients are never found because the information is not there with the physicians who see patients in the first line of care. But we see also things in other countries. We saw last week Professor Miles in Australia, who explained how he is doing good work in Australia. So there's more countries which are active on this aspect and help getting forward. But the greatest problem is that it is such a rare cancer. So the physicians which don't see many patients, if they see one patient at all in their whole lifetime, then it's a lot.
Yeah, and I think with technology and maybe the silver lining in our global COVID pandemic experience has given us this opportunity where we've all had to become a little more comfortable using technology to connect and to beyond just doing, you know, Dr. Google or other things like that. But, you know, I see this as a great step forward for us in the cutaneous lymphoma world to really do more together. The more that we know, the more that we can collect, use all of our strengths together. Yeah. And then again, to be able to deliver within the country, within the language, within the culture, within the scope of how cutaneous lymphoma is treated within the country to help people get the best that they can. You know, I like you, Miki, my big dream is a world free of cutaneous lymphoma.
We want to reach out to all the patients and that they get the best care that's possible in all countries. And the healthcare systems is one of the thresholds which we have to to get over with, because it must not depend on money if you are treated well.
And that's a huge challenge. And that was one of the reasons for this particular conference, we decided to take a little different tactic on the sessions to be more about the different health systems in the different regions, because they are so different and the experience of the individual is going to be different based upon where they live and the health system and the access to therapies, access to specialty centers. All of those things play an important role. And, you know, the more I learn about the different health systems, the more my mind is blown by all the differences and how challenging it is. And if you're not knowledgeable, which who is, unless you end up with a diagnosis and you scramble to become knowledgeable fast, you know, how do you do this? And how do you know what questions to ask? And how do you know who's the specialist closest to you? I'll share it, which was really wonderful. When we did our other patient conference in June, which had more disease information and things, we had a couple from Malaysia join us. And, you know, their experience is totally different from everyone else's. And I will say that Professor Vermeer was gracious and willing to help, you know, bridge the gap, talk to their physician, be the expert, and he's amazing. But I will say all the cutaneous lymphoma physicians that I've had the privilege of meeting and interacting with around the world are also very passionate about helping and supporting, but sometimes they don't know. So being able to come from the patient side, and then if we know, we can then help and reach out and try to network.
Well, our goal is also to help what patients need, and not only the good treatments, but also all the other aspects of life which patients care about.
Quality of life.
Yeah.
We were very curious to this this conference, and what can we learn from this and from each other. Perhaps it's a little bit, but every little bit is helping.
I know. I have to say I wasn't sure we should do this. Right. And it was like, oh my gosh, what the heck are we doing? And why take this on? This is such a big thing. But I'm so passionate that everyone that is impacted by cutaneous lymphoma can find us all and know that they're not alone, and that there are people that can help, and people who have walked in your shoes, you know. You know, that first, when you get the diagnosis and that fear and that terror, right? Mm-hmm. As you had said. And then there are those of us that have been here for a long time and have had an experience that we are happy to share, that may be helpful to someone else.
We hope that patients who in the future, they get diagnosed earlier than Mika has, because there have been many years and many dermatologists also in university center which didn't recognize what it could be. But there are of course other illnesses which look a little bit like cutaneous lymphoma at the start, but dermatologists should be aware that it could be something else, and there are methods of finding out earlier.
And that's a big job, but I think if we can begin that kind of, and what you're doing with the nurses and educating, I think that's absolutely brilliant. And I know, and now I have a lot more questions like, ooh, how are you doing that? How can we find other ways to do that in other places? And I think that's very, very exciting. And being able to share as a global community what people have learned or what they might be doing to help move everything forward to get the diagnosis. You know, there's some interesting new research going on with regards to new diagnostic tools and things of that nature. But I think one of the biggest hurdles is that education to the non-specialty realms, because they're dealing with so much. And in many countries, you know, you're going through your general practitioner, you're not even, you know, that's another gap, you know, and if you're thinking general physician that has to know a little bit about everything, there's no way that cutaneous lymphoma is even going to enter their mind. So how do we make sure people can be referred to dermatology? And then once you're in dermatology, how do you then get referred to a specialist to really understand the disease? Even if you're treated locally, that's totally great if you can do that kind of collaboration.
Well, some of the research which is done in Leiden is to be able to recognize the different lymphomas, cutaneous lymphoma, and at the earlier stage by simple methods. So, and that's and that is possible, then it's a great progress.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that speaks to the other piece. Like, I didn't know that that was happening. So now knowing that that research is going on, and when some of the outcomes are available for that and can be shared, then maybe again, collaborative efforts to say, let's use that information and create more communications or training or whatever back out into that dermatology community. And maybe we can do that through some of the professional organizations and other ways, right, to get to a broad.
Yeah, we're trying as foundation also to get to the dermatologists in the Netherlands. There are about 500 or 600 in the Netherlands. So most of them probably don't know what cutaneous lymphoma is, or they have heard of it, of course, but they don't know exactly. So that's one of the problems. But as I said, some of the research, which is going to be started, I think, in the next year, is to get, it's an international cooperation research from Leiden, which is aimed at getting a better diagnosis at an earlier stage by simple methods. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I think that's brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant. So we'll keep tabs on that, and you'll keep us posted on.
Yeah, we're sure.
Things go along,
we'll share everything we know.
Right there. That's very cool. That's very cool. Tana, Miki, I can't wait for more things that we're going to do together. Going forward on behalf of everybody. So thank you, everyone.